It's agreed then, Tim. We're going to smash the world record for the longest TV interview.
12 hours and 30 seconds.
And the longest one-on-one broadcast in the history of the world.
24 hours.
Great. What's your plan?
My plan? I thought you had a plan.
I don't have a plan. I had an idea. You were supposed to have the plan.
No. You were supposed to have the plan. For goodness sake, it's on at the end of the month.
I don't have a plan.
I don't have a plan.
You don't have a plan. Well, in truth, we do have a plan, and that plan, of course, is to break that world record, the Guinness World Record, for the longest TV interview, setting a new mark of 26 hours. Good afternoon to all our viewers across New Zealand and across the world as we stream live on the internet for this record attempt. And, of course, that plan is to discuss the life and times of a New Zealander with a colourful past that transcends more than six decades. And that includes adventures, trials, and I mean trials, tribulations, some failures, but an abundance of success. Only he can recount that story in his own highly entertaining, inimitable way. Please welcome Mr. Tim Shadbolt. Smile for the cameras. Take a seat.
She'd tell us off and say, you're wrecking, you'll never get a job as a school teacher. And then she'd revert to lying, Mum, and she would make applications for me. So I'd be at home in the student flat with big Che Guevara posters on the wall, and Mum would say, and then a letter would arrive from the teacher's training college or from the fire brigade saying, thank you for your application, Mr. Shadbolt, to join us. And it was Mum writing them all, of course, and forging my signatures. So it was, she wanted the best for us.
But that's obvious.
But it balanced out later in life anyway, where I was able to help her with lots of things. And she came to Invercargill with me, and we spent, you know, the last 15 years of her life with us here and loved it. So it was a great relationship, and I just slept on the floor in her room for the last 5 days of her life. So.
Back to something, again, a little bit darker. An expression you used in the book, and you've mentioned your stepfather a couple of times. Mum remarried, and I'll quote you, a deeply disturbed Czech refugee. Which is a couple of references you've made already tonight. You've talked about it, hardworking, you know, expected a lot. Put that in context for me.
Well, they just say you should never speak ill of the dead and all that, you know, and I don't.
But we always do. So.
Well, I don't in a way, Tom, because although he had this sort of bloody. Nasty thing of punishing others, and I think he got it from the bloody Germans in a way, of punishing others for crimes that others had done. So if I had a bath and didn't clean the bath after me, he'd grab my little brother and make him kneel on the back porch and then pour cold water over him. And so the guilt that I felt, because my poor little brother, you know, he's only about three, was suffering this sort of torture and that. But he had never physically hit us, you know. But it was kind of, and he got my other brother then, who'd done some petty crime, and put him in a septic tank. We'd half finished a septic tank at the orchard, and he was yelling all night, just wailing and crying, you know. So we decided it had to be resolved, me and my other brother, and we'd shoot him. So we got these guns, and we all had guns anyway, but we also got a 3-0 from farm next door, Mr. Tate's farm. He ran the youth club. He's the one who taught me the box I was telling you about before. Turned the couch over and agreed we'd all open fire together when he walked through the door, you know. And but Mum walked through the door and of course saw us with the guns, screamed, blew me up, oh my God, what are you doing? And so we all scampered and hid in the bush in this little, we had a shack. And of course, Mum called the cops, but policing was, see, in our day, everything was so different. I mean, now it'd be the armed offenders squad would be out there and it'd be hell to pay. But Mayor Robbie, oh, he was a different kettle of fish, you know. He was a motorbike rider, he was a nudist, he was a multi-billionaire, he was in the Communist Party, he was a sort of complex character, really. And he decided that packet of jelly beans was a direct attack on his character. So he called the police. And the police arrested me under the Grocers Act of 1893 for distributing food in a public place without a permit. So we went up before the judge. I said, I'm not going to bloody pay this fine, you fascists from hell, you know. And then she said, right, prison, bang, off I went again. Movies show a country in a whole different way to a whole lot of different people. And I think, you know, it's often that, I mean, maybe the best thing we'll get out of the Burt Munro movie might be the Burt Munro.
One world record. Take it.
Thank you. I love you, Tom.
That's fantastic.
Thank you
very much.
Well,
we're going to take
it. We're going to keep talking. We don't want to blow the ring on, Tom. So,
that's the first. That's the first.
Thanks.
I hope that will make to your future autobiography one of the great achievements.
It's a bit of a guessing art for me.
We just don't know, Tom, and I don't think we're going to be able to figure it out on this journey.
We haven't solved many of the world. We've discussed some of the world problems. We haven't solved them all. Yeah. We've done very well.
Nearly sorted out the Middle East.
Tell us what you said and the aftermath.
Thank you, Tom. I was hoping you'd ask that question. I think sometimes, I don't know what it is, it's probably a multiple number of factors, but sometimes I think I get bored in committee meetings and they go on and on and on, and sometimes I just feel like being provocative and just seeing what happens. I don't know, maybe I've some deep psychological bad toilet training, I don't know what it is. And I said, yeah, well, all right, well, all this money we seem to be spending on all this IT stuff, how do we know it's not just a fad like the hula hoop? Now, I knew it would create a reaction. I knew all the onliners would be furious and tell me I was a dinosaur and I was backward and how can I run a city if I don't know how it all the computer works and all that. And I expected that. What I didn't expect, Tom, was this outrage from hula hoopers all around the world saying, how dare you call us a fad? Is that we've been around since 3000 BC. The Egyptians started hula hooping by making them out of grapevines, and then the Romans made wooden hula hoops, and on they went. And the first rehearsal we've got's in the Scottish Hall, and she comes spinning through the front door like a top with a dress up round her head somewhere, wraps her legs around my waist and arches her head back and says, this is the rumba, the dance of love. As luck would have it. That very...
It's another world record.
What did I say?
It's 24 hours.
Oh, sorry.
24 hours. 24.
Oh, we're going.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We're not finished yet. It was just getting good, that answer.
Well, am I? I wondered what I'd said. I didn't know.
24. Carry on, rumba. Yes, tell me about the rumba.
Oh, the rumba. So arches her head back and says, this is the rumba, the dance of love. As luck would have it, at that very moment in time, my partner walks into the Scottish Hall and I tell you the thunder clouds were gathering. And I got a home from rehearsals that night, she looked me straight in the eye and said, "Don't you find that young woman attractive?" And I said, "No, no, not at all," I said, "not at all." And I got a week on the couch for lying. I hope you all enjoyed the show, because it was hell on earth for me, let me tell you. It's that ancient art, and it's still right today, after all that technology that we've been through, so much of our life.
Going to have to stop you there, Tim. Tim, I'm sorry, we're out of time. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Probably won't need any for now.
A celebration to last throughout the years. So bring your good times and your laughter too. We gon' celebrate your party with you. Come
a concreter, a singer, a miner, and then it goes a bit downhill. Protester, let's boxer, motorcyclist, hippie, ex-con, and attempted murderer of your stepfather.
The Guinness World Records for the longest TV interview, the longest one-on-one broadcast interview, and the record for the longest single event broadcast in New Zealand's television history.